Title of the session is Human Values in Indian Higher Education in the Era of Disruption. We have Professor Sunil Rai, Vice Chancellor MIT ADT University Pune, as the chairperson of this session. Professor Sunil Rai is here. I request you to come and take your chair on the dais. We have Professor K.P. Pandey, who is the key speaker of this session. I think he's not here in this auditorium. He may be joining us anytime. We have Professor Madhumita Das, Vice Chancellor, Fakir Mohan University. Ma'am, I request you to come on the dais and take your chair. We have Professor N.K. Ahuja, Vice Chancellor Swami Vivekananda Subharti University, Meerut. I request you, sir, to come and take your chair on the dais. I request Professor Ashok Gwal, ISECT University, Bhopal, to take your chair on the dais, sir. And in this session, we have the Vice Chancellor of this particular university, Professor Samten, who will be joining us anytime because he has gone to drop His Holiness Dalai Lama. He said he will join the session in the later part. So should we wait for the speakers or should we start the session? Start. Yeah, the session is also very important. Human values in the era of disruption. How we have to sustain the indigenous, our human values, universal human values in the area of disruption. Professor Sunil Rai is from the university which propagates world peace. So I requested him to be the chairperson of this session. I request you, sir, to take over the chair and initiate the session.
Not required. Okay, not required. Okay, close it.
Sorry, I'm so sorry.
Sorry.
I'm extremely, I apologize, sir. Please come and take your chair on the dais. Somehow it slipped off. When things are very close to eyes, they tend to slip off. Yeah, I welcome Professor K.P. Pandey, the key speaker of this session. Sir, I request you to take your chair. And Professor Sunil Rai is the chairperson of this session, and he is going to initiate the session, sir.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome all the fellow panelists on the dais, and I pay my respect to all the fellow vice chancellors in the auditorium. I have, one is an announcement that has been told by Ramaji, is that the bus leaves at 4. So we have a limit up to 3:45 because 15 minutes will be required to conduct ourselves to the bus. So with that, we have 1 hour and we have 7 speakers, so we will go for 7 minutes each with some changeover and try and maintain the time as has been demonstrated well in the earlier sessions. All right. Obviously, for key speaker, sir, we will have more time and maybe 10 minutes or so. Now, I'm not using a PPT, but I'm using a cog sheet in case, so that I bind myself with the time limit of 7 minutes myself to make that initial comment. So I have to make these comments in three parts. One is I have to pay some acknowledgement. Second one is my views on the particular topic. And the third one is few experiences before I invite our key speaker to come and set the ball rolling. Acknowledgements at the outset, I would like to thank the President AIU, the Vice President AIU, the Secretary AIU, and the entire AIU team for giving me this opportunity to be here on the stage and share my views with all of you. The second acknowledgement is from the bottom of my heart, and I think all of us join in that, is to Professor Samten, the host, the Vice Chancellor of the current university, and his entire team. I think we all have been having an excellent, enriched, and enjoyable time, thanks to the kind of efforts which Samten sir and his team has put in, and we are all enjoying the fruits. So my acknowledgements, compliments, and respect to the entire team of this institution. And finally, of course, my acknowledgement and respects to all of you. As compared to most of you, I am a prodigy of a vice chancellor, because I will be just completing my 17th year now. That is far less. I have to add my naval career of 22 years to come somewhere near what you are. So all of you listening to me, is thank you very much. So this finishes the first part, Pratham Adhyay Samapt Hota Hai, which is about the acknowledgements. कल मैं डिस्कस सिंह साहब से सुबह डिस्कस कर रहा था कि आफ्टरनून सेशन में काफ़ी प्रलोभन होते हैं, जिसमें आप बड़ी ही आसानी से एक चिंतन में खो जाते हैं और उस चिंतन में खो के किसी और दुनिया में चले जाते हैं। तो आप सब जो यहाँ हैं, आपसे निवेदन है कि कृपा कर इसी दुनिया में रहें, कोशिश कीजिए जितना प्रयास हो सकता है। सो नाउ माई कमेंट्स ऑन दिस टॉपिक, एंड It's heartening that we have had some of these discussions. Ye disruption ya disruption age ka hawa kyon bana liya hai? You know, it's as has been commented in the morning, that disruption had been there throughout the age. Sancheti sir mentioned about through the history tracing. So there's nothing too scary or great or baffling about this whole aspect of disruptive era. I think all era have been disruptive. Yeah, one thing we can collectively observe is that the pace of disruption has been rapid and has been phenomenal, and that poses some concerns to educators like us, because of this particular pace and the kind of things this disruption can do, the kind of damage the disruption, if not well managed, can do, is therefore a concern. And disruption by itself is a good thing, which has been actually pointed out that it is a positive aspect and not a negative thing. Now, so if we agree that we have to live with this disruption, that we are only seeing tip of the iceberg, mind-boggling things are happening through technology, practices, geopolitical environment, changing social order, and so on and so forth. I think we are seeing it all over and at a pace that sometimes does cause a concern. So now if this has to be a reality, and if we have to manage this, and I'm looking forward to some comments from the fellow panelists as to, convinced as we are about the disruption part of it, but the also convinced about it that at this point and from here now onwards, from here on, I think the requirement in the essential aspect of value system will be much more than before, because it's good to have power, but you have to know how to use it. And with every passing day, we are going to equip ourselves with phenomenal power in any kind of technology or practice. And therefore, the aspect of value system or the value-based education, as we keep talking as a cliche, but now I think value has to become the forefront. And therefore, this topic is so relevant today and from now onwards, I suppose, because the space is only going to change. So in my views, what we need to change is, as has been discussed here, concerns have been expressed that as far as a student is concerned, this fellow says, I am learning this education basically to make my life. And you teach me physics, you teach me other core subjects, you teach me finance, management, technology, I am going to make my life out of it. You are calling off this value system and this value base, iska main kya karunga? And if I say, and there's no index of measuring the performance on value system, and if we report that the such and such student has been high on value system, if we do come up with, as we heard, some frameworks being talked about this morning, and we tell this to the corporate, I'm not certain whether the corporate is going to give some brownie points to somebody who scores high on value system. So therefore, there is a requirement of changing of the mindset. This mindset we have to change of, the change has to begin from, as Dalai Lama ji said, His Holiness, that it has to begin with us teachers. So therefore, first and foremost is the mindset change of the faculty themselves, or the management, all of us, I'm putting myself in that. The second is the change of mindset for the parents. When you talk to parents, at MIT ADT University, which is Arts, Design and Technology, I welcome all of you to please visit us. We are at 15 kilometers from Loni. It's one of the most beautiful campus. It has been blessed by the creativity of Mr. Raj Kapoor. It was his land, which we acquired. And now we have 110 acres of beautiful land there, where we have 13 different constituent units, which range from core of technology to the fine arts. And in between, we also have Vedic Sciences and School of Education. So at our university, we are very fortunate to have all kinds, all aspects which have to go in to make the value system. So when we start, when we made this Vedic Sciences ethical management compulsory, or value of ethics compulsory to all our programs, arts, design and technology, the biggest roadblock comes from the parents. And the parents, it's difficult to convince the parents as to when we are investing that particular time instead of, and thanks to AICT and others who are now saying, bring it down from 178 to 160 credits, which we have implemented in our university as far as technical programs are concerned. So the parents have to be convinced. And of course, above all, the students have to be convinced. So how do we do it? What we are trying to do there, sir, is, I think in all these aspects which are abstract, which you cannot show in terms, material terms, what we have been doing is trying to talk to them about cases of demonstration of people who have lived with high value system and have attained good results for themselves. Attention is drawn of this august audience is to, you all know about that concept of conscious capitalism, on which Dr. Jagdish Seth of Emory, my guru, had been working on it with Purdue and other universities. And that study says that top 30 companies which have lived more than 150 years, who have sustained themselves for more than 150 years, are those companies which had been conscious about humanity, about environment and so on and so forth. Example, GE, DuPont and so on and so forth. So this whole aspect of appreciation that if you are rich on value system, if you are righteous, you are going to sustain in the long run. Dalai Lamaji also said, materialistic thing, short-term gains. But in the long run, if we can demonstrate, and we can tell them, of course, what is happening to Vijay Mallya or Nirav Modi or people like that. And outstanding successes as far as businesses were concerned. But what has happened to them? I think they failed only on the value system. So the change of mindset through whichever modes we apply is, I am suggesting. And finally, we have to have the reinforcement. So we heard this morning from Dr. Sangal about the kind of program they are practicing at IIT BHU. We also have a similar program. We have adopted it after we have received details from AICT and so on and so forth. And I'm sure most of us in our respective institutions are doing a three-week induction program, an elaborate induction program, and so on and so forth. But it should not be a one-time wonder when the students come in the beginning and we bombard them, you know, with value system, ethics, morality, XYZ. And then second year, third year, law of diminishing returns, and they're back to normal. And sometimes even driven worse, because they will keep meeting people coming from industry and so on and so forth. So therefore, there have to be reinforcements. So how do we, it has to become a way of life rather than just a curriculum issue. And that's where is the real challenge as to every aspect. So some experiences that brings me to my third part is that in our university, we have created a separate school of personal development. This personal is very highly towards value system, ethics, and so on and so forth. Because we know that the agenda is large. So we don't want to task our existing institutions, you do this also. So this will be a one more thing to do. It is not one more thing to do, it's an institutional activity. And therefore, we are now investing as a, in focused manner in a school of personal development with its own director and departments and so on and so forth. And what do we do is we have created a structure there. And that structure has few of the guidelines, which is, as was mentioned by Professor Karmakar in the morning, How about non-technical students? Technical students, we are now putting the framework for technical students, teach them culture, sculpture, painting, arts, and so on and so forth. We have in the structure, in each term, till about third term we are devoting for entrepreneurship, fourth term we leave them for value-added programs. I'm talking about four-year programs. The first and second year, we are dedicatedly devoting in a proper measured CGPA audit courses to do courses in physical health, mental health, and spirituality. Every student will have to pick up some program of health. We are proposing yoga. We also have got other aspects like Zumba and aerobics and so on and so forth. But every student has to pick up one item to pick up a health routine. Then we, of course, have regular Vedic classes. We have yoga classes, meditation, compulsory for all of them, not just for technical, but for all the students. We are also making it compulsory for all the faculty and the staff members. Because if you're talking of sustenance, staff is a very important aspect of ensuring the value system. So we have a structure in place. We are doing across. So as we said, we are teaching cultural subjects to technology students. Likewise, we are teaching technology to all the students from arts. We have got film and television. We've got fine arts, performing arts, and so on and so forth. And Vedic sciences. And of course, we are collaborating with like-minded institutions. For example, we are collaborating very strongly with Bajaj. Rajiv Bajaj, as you know, is an exponent of yoga himself. He believes in homeopathy. He believes in the Indian way of life. Rajiv, we request him to come and spend more time. Because what happens is, if we tell as teachers, the impact is X. The industry people come and tell them the impact is 3X. And therefore, the same thing that which I want to say, I'm saying it through my industry partners. And there's another thing we all take delight in foreign. So if my Indian professor is saying, because unfortunately, the importance is in who is saying, then what is being said. And therefore, Dr. XYZ from California saying something, student said, wow, this is it, you know. So there is a Mahesh Yogi University in the US. So the vice chancellor from there comes and spends almost in every 2 months about 5 days on campus. So we keep on reinforcing these thoughts to students through the way of life. And finally, we are very strict with defaulters. Particularly, we say you fail in academic subjects, no problem. We will give you chances to make up your exam, support you with tutorials, and so on and so forth. But 1, 2, and 3, you are out. As far as there's no compromise on value systems. So therefore, we are actually implementing that with an iron handle. So these were a few of the thoughts that, sir, I wanted to share with you as far as this very important topic is concerned. And now I have already said that for the key speaker, we will have the privilege of listening to you, sir, for about 10 minutes. But for the other speakers, I'm requesting that if you do it in 5 minutes, we will all clap for you very loudly. If you do it in 7 minutes, we will clap for you. So I think this is incentive enough. And with that, I will now invite Professor K.P. Pandey, former Vice Chancellor, Himachal Pradesh University, the key speaker. Sir, for your comments, please. Thank you very much. I need double it. I finished it in less than 7 minutes. Yes.
Professor Sunil Rai and my fellow presenters who are sharing the dais with us. Professor Samteen, Vice Chancellor of this university. I'm a little in a fix because I had presented a write-up for a longer period and I have to shorten it. And I have been given 10 minutes. I would like to make it 8 to 9 minutes. And I will compress whatever I have to say. To begin with, I would like to say that at present juncture, the entire world is witnessing major innovations in science and technology, changes in the constraints to economies and politics, and transformation in demographic and social structures in the emerging new imperatives of globalization. These upheavals, which are likely to further accelerate in the present century, will place considerable strain on the education community, in particular, to respond to growing needs and to meet the challenges of a rapidly changing world, especially for promoting concerns for human values centered on feelings of universal brotherhood, empathy, tolerance, respect, compassion, and reciprocity in relationship. With the entry into the 21st century, developing countries are facing a multiplicity of challenges in their quest for development. Taking up these challenges squarely requires properly trained and adequately prepared leaders to address the various socio-economic needs arising especially from the emphasis on human values. In this context, the specific educational needs and value-centric predicament of the leaders of tomorrow must be realistically comprehended, appreciated, and met. There is no, in my construction, there is no antinomy visualized between the concepts of human value rooted in equality and the quality domain leading to excellence. In fact, when a social system is so devised that equality is ensured, implicitly it also sets forth that everybody will be provided opportunity to realize the best he or she is capable of. We must therefore foster a conception of quality which may be applied to every degree of ability and to every socially acceptable activity. A missile may blow up on the launching pad because the designer was incompetent or because the mechanic who adjusted the last valve was incompetent. The same is true of everything else in our society. We need excellent physicists and excellent mechanists. We need excellent cabinet members and excellent first grade teachers, but we also need in them a stuff entitling them to be called a good human being. The tone and fiber of a society depend upon a pervasive and almost universal striving for good performance. The concept of equality implies that in the final matters of life and death, all men are equally worthy of our care and concern. As early as 1775, George Mason observed, "We come equals into the world, and equal shall we go, and equal shall we go out of it." Chesterton also talked on the same wavelength when he reminded us that in an accident at sea, we do not cry bad citizens overboard. Beyond this, we believe that men are equal in the possession of certain legal, civil, and political rights. We believe, with Aristotle, that the only state is the one in which all men are equal before law. Long back, the seers of Isha Upanishad had averred, "Yastu sarvani bhutani atma eva anupashyati Sarvabhuti sichatmanam tatona vijugupsati. He who sees all beings in the self and the self in all beings, he never turns away from it. The concept of quality may be interpreted to indicate effectiveness and efficiency, relevance to human and environment needs and conditions, something more in relation to the pursuit of excellence and human betterment. As we has been advised in the Chandogya Upanishad, yadeva vidyaya karoti shraddhaya upanishada tadeva viryavattaram bhavati. That is, competence, confidence and commitment ensure convergence leading to quality. In this enunciation, it has to be noted that quality is a dynamic idea and exact definitions are neither actually called for nor are helpful. The efficiency of any institution turns out on the quality of those attracted to and retained in the service of that institution. As Sir Charles Grant Robertson, the erstwhile Vice Chancellor of University of Birmingham, asserts, second-rate equipment and first-rate brains will achieve more than first-rate equipment and second-rate brains. Professors are not made by calling them such in a university calendar, and more than admirals and generals are produced by conferring the rank in the army and navy gazettes. Two or three impressive personalities, two or three brains of a truly high caliber will in a single generation vitalize and give distinction to a university, and more than two or three such at one time, even in large university, are rare than is often supposed. In India, it has been observed and experienced that while policy formulations and planning processes have been commended and appreciated, the issues and problems of the implementation stage have generally been allowed to remain unsolved or unresolved. The decline in the quality of education and the concern for human values permeates from initially school education to the arena of higher education. Unless this vast base of the cognitive capital, that is, products of the schools are improved, the quality of university education, in my opinion, will not attain desirable results. The mismatch between policy and implementation, theory and practice, is glaringly evident across the entire spectrum of education. The universities have a responsibility to study and monitor these discrepancies at the implementation stage in their total perspectives. Several of these can be identified easily and readily. With the advent of 21st century, the challenges of higher education have attained a menacing proportion, especially in all pervasive era of disruption, suspicion, and jealousies. It has to be noted that the challenge of higher education of today's university in particular has to be understood, as Robert F. Goheen, the president of Princeton University, has to put it in terms of some of the internal tensions that give it dynamism, using the word tension in a Heraclitean sense and meaning a cross pull, not of a good thing against an evil thing, but most often between compelling goods. The modern university has been conceptualized as one of the few places where the individual can be greater than the group and his imaginings given free play. Of all the places, university is a place where if teaching is sound and alive and human values allowed to permeate at all levels, students learn to do their own thinking and valuing and their own reflecting. It is a place where the search for truth and value must be unending. To quote Goheen again, when a person inveighs against a university because it does not often offer training in surf-costing or sales promotion or mink ranching, he is revealing a distorted notion of it as a supermarket rather than as a place of inquiry, investigation, and value exploration. Or again, when someone sneers at the testimony of university professors as too theoretical, he is really saying he distrusts theory, which is an aspect of hard thought, and is precisely one of the prime things a university exists to nurture and pursue. Why should a university not dispense dogma, not become a supermarket, not scorn theory? Ask Gwain. He answers, because our civilization and the very existence of free and open society requires places where the adventurous, uninhibited search for improved knowledge, for rational understanding and rational principles and value inculcation can be carried out. The dual demand on our universities for quality teaching and research is the source of another tension to realizing the true form and character. It may be asserted that brought into effective interaction, teaching and scholarship produce a harmony that cannot be achieved by either separately. Pursued together and grounded in the ultimate concerns for basic human values of interdependence and mutual respect, they guarantee an atmosphere of learning that invigorates and gives added points to both. To quote Rabindranath Tagore, a teacher can never truly teach unless he is still learning. A lamp can never light another lamp unless it continues to burn its flame. The teacher who has come to the end of his subject, who has no living traffic with his knowledge, but merely repeats his lessons to his students, can only lead their minds, load their minds, he cannot quicken them. Truth not only must inform, but also must improve. If the inspiration dies out and the information only accumulates, then truth loses its infinity, unquote. And obviously, in a situation like this, the scope for nurturing human values gets considerably thwarted. The scenario of higher education in India, when looked at from these basic enunciations of tensions inherent in the very character of our universities, presents a somewhat dismal picture. In terms of the ancient Vedic envisioning, the university has to be a place where noble thoughts and ideas will be permitted to flow from everywhere. Ano bhadraha kratavo yantu vishvata. This is the mantra from Vedas. It, in essence, a university has to provide a leadership to the society for the well-being of the entire humanity. It is probably in this context that it is said to be the lighthouse of the society, for whose sustenance it probably in this context is for whose sustenance it is established. Of late, however, there is a growing realization that of all the sectors, it is the university which presents a disparaging situation in respect of its roles and responsibility. This is more so in the case of Indian universities when viewed squarely in the new era of globalization and interdependence overtaking the dynamism of international organizations in particular and that of local and national levels in general. Most of the university's calendar is virtually eaten up by the rituals of admission, elections, and examinations, interspersed with the students, teachers, and employees' agitations and activist moves. One does not know for sure as to how many actual hours of meaningful teacher-student interactions take place in the various faculties which constitute the university system. The observance of university calendar with a minimal 180 to 280 days of instructional programs becomes more or less a ritual without adequate evidence of authentic participation on the part of teachers and students. As a consequence thereof, the quest for quality, pursuit of human values to be adumbrated in the content and process of education, get more often than not only a superficial treatment by the so-called experts and practitioners of higher education. All this signalizes the surfacing of the deep-rooted malaise from which our educational system has been allowed to suffer for long and is still being made to suffer it. One wonders whether there is any hope for a revamp of the system. Is our national and state leadership genuinely interested in facilitating the processes of metamorphosis so actually needed at the present juncture? Towards a human value paradigm, I'll conclude in 2 minutes. Values are classified in a number of ways. According to John M. Heffron, long back, if the social sciences have taught us anything over the last century, it is that we live in stratified societies, stratified by class, race, ethnicity, gender, occupation, family status, religion, and education. As a matter of pure economy, relatively few value dimensions constitute the organizing principles for hundreds of specific beliefs and attitudes. The former may be termed as the core values of a society, the latter its subordinate or instrumental values. The problem of an empirical classification of values is to identify these penultimate generalities that people judge to be intrinsically satisfying and that anchor all the other desiderata that affect their lives. 3 popular ranking models in respect of value ordering are prevalent. These are from the policy sciences, from sociology, and from anthropology. One of the widely reported is Lasswille Value Dictionary, which has been used to study political behavior, development performance, jurisprudence, educational policy, and of late, positive human rights. The basic scheme employed refers to 8 different normative principles, like principle of power, principle of enlightenment, principle of wealth, principle of well-being, principle of skill, principle of affections, principle of respect, and lastly, principle of rectitude. Revisiting the content and process of higher education, therefore, entails emphasis on a development of a specific pedagogy with an authentic integration of knowledge, skills, and human values, also including education in human values and life skills. These are more than mere concerns of teaching. Long back, Norman H. Henderson identified 7 basic functions of the university which need attention even now. These are to provide a place for pure culture and learning, number one. Number two, to conduct research and advance the boundaries of knowledge. Number three, to serve as a training school for the profession. Number four, to turn out trained leaders for every walk of life. And then next, to act as a liaison between the so-called academic person and the good, solid, practical man. And next, to produce men and women of character and high ideas. And lastly, to be the custodian of intellectual freedom, safeguarding liberty, and unfettered search for truth and promotion of concerns for human values. To conclude, it will be pertinent in this connection to quote one of our learned friends, Professor Raja Rai Singh, who rightly observed, values are the doors of perception through which we look at the world and ourselves and interpret the experience and make it intelligible to ourselves. He asserted that to shut these doors on the learners on grounds of detached view or moral neutrality or irrelevance of values in the preparation of earning a living is our going for education without a purpose. Thus, education that is infused with a continuing sense of values
should mean deeper moral sensibility and greater human understanding, so that the learners, as they have more education, can more clearly perceive the barriers that divide and separate one human being from another, and feel grounded in five basic human values of freedom, creativity, love, wisdom, and empathy. In the end, it may be admitted that the components of education in human values and life skills should be made an integral and prominent part of the various disciplines being formally taught at present. This should arise from infusion of approach to course designing, as has been contemplated for environment education, human rights, and various empowerment programs in our country. In any case, the various concepts and skills have to be synthesized and integrated with a focus on promoting personality traits, which will engender basic sanskaras of national integration, fellow feelings, tolerance, empathy, and commitment to the quality of life and living in the local, national, and global levels, so as to fulfill the truly Indian vision of Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashyavit Dukh Bhag Bhavet. This was the mantra advocated through the ages. Let us now remember and reflect on the cardinal messages embodied in our Upanishads. Three things make a person great: a university organization great, a collectivity called nation great, and these are firm conviction in the power of goodness and truth. Number two, absence of jealousy and suspicion. And number three, helping those who are doing good or trying to be good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving us a very comprehensive account of how the value system has to be understood, viewed, organized, and impregnated in our education system. Thank you very much, sir. With the permission of House, what we would do is we'll reserve the questions to the end. You may like to please note down your queries, and then we may have a 5 minutes panel at the end. So it is on me now to invite Professor Madhumita Das, Vice Chancellor, Fakir Mohan University, Odisha, to make her comments, please. Just to remind that the 7 minutes rule is now in vogue.
Yeah, I very well remember. Namaskar. A very good afternoon to you all. After hearing from yesterday, and particularly after hearing today's from the Holy Highness Dalai Lama Ji, I think I don't have anything to speak. And you also don't have anything more to hear, because after taking Amrit, there is nothing left to take more about. So still then, I will take some few minutes to you. What I really believe that why this value education has been inducted in this particular seminar, because I think something somewhere has gone wrong in our Indian higher education system. Because when we look at the reports, they say that Indian universities, they do not come under 100 universities as the global scenario goes. And also, one report says that 85% of our engineering students are not employable. And also another thing I see, there has to be some drastic changes that needed to be brought in into our higher education. That is, like 3 decades ago, when I was in, means we were in college, I was in college or school days, that there was nothing like environmental studies. But now it has been, or it has made compulsory in all graduation stages in arts, science, commerce. So similarly, I think the time has come we have to incorporate value education mandatory in all subjects. That will also help us in going or reaching our goal, whatever we are being discussing from yesterday, and then we all are feeling the same way. So very quickly, I will just go through my slides. Why do we need value education? It is known to all of you that we want that education by which a character is formed, strength of mind is increased, the intellect is expanded, and by which one can stand on one own feet. So educated people have ideas which will enhance them to gain prosperity, security, and social well-being. And why we need values, I will not elaborate this because we all are hearing from the last yesterday. So what it values also makes us realize what we are is more important than what we have. That means there is a need for a paradigm shift from the materialistic life to the spiritual life. And if we look at the past India, I will just give some examples. Where are those persons like Harishchandra, who was the great example of his humility, and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, if you talk about Rani Jhansi, the never say die spirit, or if you talk about King Ashoka, or you take about our Mahatma Gandhi, who has shown the entire world the power of non-violence. So what I believe that why the value or we have become more materialistic, the two main causes, I think one is the ancient Gurukul system was very good for the educational system, and also now we are having nuclear family system. That means these two are the key causes, you can say, for deterioration in our value system. So gurus, where are the gurus or the rishis who had that knowledge from the present day based on their own spiritual experiences, and in a sense they imparted knowledge from the future by their own vision of the distant future in which they were alone had access. That is why they were called as Trikal Darshi or Trikal Gyanis. We don't have that sort of teachers in the present day. And also the joint family system, the value comes from the grandmothers, the grandparents, through storytelling, and that is how it comes from the family first, and then the children, they go to the school, and then they inculcate the values. So that is, then what is the real meaning of education? Does education make one wiser, happier, or make one a better human being, or just to go into any company, any factory, and then earn something? I think the education, the themes of our times is exponential growth of new knowledge, the globalization of commerce and culture, and the increasing diversity of population, the growing needs of our communities, and then the wants are unlimited. So the compressed time scales and non-linear nature of the transfer of knowledge from campus laboratories into the commercial marketplace. Now, somehow also I believe that who decides what our curriculum would be, whether we decide or the market decides, because we are saying that we must impart education which will give them employment. We are not very sure or very concerned about what the knowledge which the students should get or what the values they should have, but rather whether what sort of employment they will have. So misdirected educational system is the main reason, and then our curriculum somehow inculcating means we have introduced the vocational skill 25% in it is mandatory by the UGC, and it is designed purely for money making that promotes ultimately in their life jealousy, hatred, and rivalry instead of virtues like compassion and honesty. So present day scenario, the three E's of the basic education is examination, employment, and empowerment. So why, I will not repeat this, why value education should be a part of the curriculum that we are going to discuss and we have already discussed. So that as the students, they come from the family to the higher educations and they go to the society to prove themselves. And somewhere if we do not have value education at the school or college or university level, then we cannot have good human beings. And the students' focus have to be changed from enhancing hidden talents or values to just make them eligible to earn well, but we have to make them professionally equipped. So the children nowadays, they are educated, but they are unaware of the ways of its practical application, and that is why they are unemployed and they have a sort of frustration. And ultimately, we see the IIT students even committing suicide, and further, they send their parents to the old age homes. That is a common practice now. So another thing is lack of extracurricular activities should be given priority, which will either maybe through quizzes, the few games and dance or music. I heard some resource person talking about fine arts. Also any sort of music, it has been made compulsory in their curriculum. We can also think of that and applying. But one has to be very cautious about when we are talking about value education, it has to be a hidden agenda, because if we say that it is made compulsory, then we may have also some, as I have already heard, that parents object to it and students also will object to it, but we must go hand in hand for the changes, because it's not about doing things right, but doing the right things. And how to have a process of value inculcation, that four steps. We have to be very sensitive, we have to identify the appropriate values, internalizing the values and practicing the values. But I think the teachers, only teachers have a greater responsibility to solve this problem. And then we can, I have given you some examples, like we can have science, change is necessary, metamorphosis is necessary. Whenever we talk about any change, there comes a resistance. So there is nothing in a caterpillar which changes to a butterfly. There are the few steps which goes through the caterpillar and then the metamorphosis takes place. So we have to take some time to cocoon ourselves, time to isolate ourselves. Perhaps if each of us would take some cocooning time, we could begin our own metamorphosis. Five levels of education, I will skip. Okay. The continuity of change. Change is there. The only constant is change. We are going to have a change in higher education, that we are going to have value education in our curriculum. And I think like we have made the MOOC, the SWAYAM portal, the CBCS syllabus, and also the skill has made mandatory, we must have value education. I would also like all the esteemed distinguished vice chancellor sitting over here, if we take a drastic step to inculcate or incorporate this as a mandatory part of our curriculum, then only we can see things put in a right place, and we can, yes, and our university, as we know today, rather the current constellation of diverse institutions comprising the higher education enterprise, which change in profound ways to save the changing world. Thank you so much. Just I would like to quote our Prime Minister Narendra Modi. All are sitting over here. Vakt bahut kam hai, dam laga do. Kuch ko main jagati hoon, kuch ko tum jaga do. Let us be united and fight for it and bring in some drastic changes incorporating value education to our curriculum. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, madam. I'll now invite Professor N.K. Ahuja sir, Vice Chancellor Swami Vivekanand Subharti University Meerut, to make his speech, please.
Good afternoon, Honorable Chair, dignitaries on the dais, off the dais. Enough has been really said. I don't think there is anything much left to be said. Anyway, I'll cut it short. The formalities, basically, I'm from Meerut. Meerut is, Subharti University is about 45 kilometers away from Delhi. We run about 14 faculties, 18 colleges in the campus. The only thing to be added is we have just started Subharti School of Buddhist Studies, keeping in mind the human values. The session would be starting from this session. Our motto remains Shiksha Seva Sanskar Evam Rashtriyata. So let's understand is the topic. If we read the topic again, let's understand human values in the age of disruption. The disruptive technologies in higher education can be, I say insist, in education can be named as online learning, competency-based education, Internet of Things, virtual reality. The current era of innovations and technologies has led us to advanced human civilization, undoubtedly. At the same time, it has caused unprecedented challenges. Present higher education is all about information enrichment and skill generation, but grossly deficient in human values. Advances in science and innovations and technologies, better understanding of physical realities, conveniences of daily life, undoubtedly, but has caused issues at human level. Lack of clarity on life goals, contradictions, stress, relationships and family, mutual understanding, mistrust, insincerity, generation gap, communal conflicts, exploitation and strife, terrorism, violence, corruption, unethical practices. Today's reality remains high IQ, less emotions, advanced medicines, poor health, high income, less peace of mind, lots of friends on social media, but no friends. Today's reality also remains more degrees, less common sense, costly watches, no time, lots of humans, less humanity, touched moon, but neighbors unknown. Students are taught history, science, geography, and so on with the whole sole aim of getting employability or get through competitive exams of engineering, medical, CAT or GRE. Only final aim is career. The very purpose of education is individuals live their life in harmony with self, family, society and nature. There are certain fundamental issues which are important to one and all, that's happiness, welfare, aspirations, goal and success. Whole lot of things we believe in, as we hear, see, read, or told by our parents. These beliefs convert into aspirations and they keep changing. There are conflicting beliefs. They are not same as for everyone, but they are not universal either. Beliefs cannot ensure happiness or result in harmony. Values are our purpose set of beliefs about what is important, unimportant, right or wrong. That when we are confronted with the choices, options, or moral dimensions, the decisions will indicate what values we hold. Human values give worthiness and respect to life. Technology is only means to achieve what is considered as valuable. Technology cannot decide what is valuable without the knowledge what is universally valuable. Technology can be aimless, directionless, and rather than constructive, can be destructive at times. It is only understanding the value which can decide appropriate technology and its application. Responsibility of educators is to enable the resolution of these issues. What is valuable to human being? Technology is only means to achieve whatever is valuable to the human being. That is what is called as value education. It is a holistic education concept of morality and ethics, duty, honesty, sincerity, kindness, compassion, and should be imparted to all to live in harmony and all-round development. Developments of value starts at home, school, college, and society at large thereafter. When a person is in harmony, aspirations can be fulfilled by wisdom and skills. Values and skill go hand in hand. Knowledge, good health, coordination, outcome-based education, happiness, moral environment, population, human rights and duties, health, Indian culture, yoga, history and freedom. Solution lies in teaching the universal human values. Values can be taught. Impact may be slow, but it's sweeping. Its practice and teaching in higher education remains a must. Thank you so very much. I hope I have stuck to the time.
I think this needs a double clap because sir has finished almost in 5 or 6 times. Thank you very much, sir. For may I now invite Professor Bhuvanesh Sharma, Maharshi Mahesh Yogi University, Katni. Please, sir. I am seeing a chit in front of me which says that I am arranging the tea inside the auditorium, so there is no rush.
Pardon?
I said, I am arranging the tea inside the auditorium.
There's no.
Sir, Ravi with the speaker. All right, sir, please.
Bhuvanesh. This one.
And it's all right. From here, no? So this is true?
Oh, yes.
All right, sir. So you can please relax and listen to us more peacefully.
Narayana Samarambha, Sri Shukacharya Madhyamam, Shankaracharya Paryantam, Vande Guru Paramparam, Ya Kundindu Tushar Har Dhavla, Ya Shubhra Vastravata, Ya Veenavar Danda Manditkara, Ya Shweta Padmasana, Ya Brahmachu Shankar Prabhativir, Devai Sada Vandita, Samam Patu Saraswati Bhagavati, Nishesha Jadhyapaha. Professor Sunil Rai, our chairman, chairperson, Professor Samtain, all our fellow speakers, and dear Vice Chancellors, it is really a great joy for me to be here, especially on the occasion of, we can say, values in higher education in this disruptive age. The word disruptive actually is can be seen in many ways. One disruption is that the technology is advancing at a fast pace, and that is causing many changes in economy and in the life of individual. It can also be taken in from other angle that the whole life, because of this modern science and technology, on one hand, we are having progress because we can go faster to any place, means of communications are better, but simultaneously, the stress is also increasing. And not only the stress in the individual, but the whole environment, we can say, the collective consciousness and the whole environment is also being disrupted. So that is another angle of seeing at this disruptive knowledge. Now here, because most of the time we are talking of engineering, so I want to introduce the engineering of consciousness. The title actually of the talk itself is Self-Referral Technologies. Because till now, what we are teaching to students, we are teaching how to program computers. But we have not taught and we have not thought of how to program the consciousness, which is the, we can say, receptor of the all the knowledge. Every time we are talking of, we will tell them what are the values. You have Satya, you have Ahimsa, you have Aste, you have Brahmacharya. So many qualities are there. There are innumerable qualities that we want to incorporate in the students and the faculty. But somehow we have not told them how to evolve the consciousness. Consciousness is what? Consciousness, we can say, is whatever knowledge we gain. The knowledge we gain is at the level of human consciousness. And that consciousness, human consciousness, has the ability to go to the finer point, finest of the finer, and it can also have the broader consciousness. So when we talk, we want to incorporate values. We have to incorporate universal values. Universal values means wherever one goes, whether one is an engineer, whether one is a doctor, whatever he may be doing professionally in his life, he should be able to act according to the situation in the right manner. In our Ramcharitmanas, it has been mentioned that Bhagwan Ram told to Lakshman, Raghuvan Shinkar says, Vahu, man kupanth pagdharai nakau. Means the people from India, they have the ability that the mind will not go astray. mind will also be in accordance with the laws of nature. So that universal value we can inculcate through a technology, and the technology is to develop the consciousness. How we develop the consciousness? It says anuraniyan mahato mahyan. The consciousness we can take to that level which has ability to comprehend unbounded and also the point, the infinite value and the point value at the same time. This human nervous system, which we say that even devatas, they really look for the human nervous system. So this human nervous system has the ability to comprehend the infinity. And I am very happy that we were having the blessings of His Holiness Dalai Lama Ji, who started with that we have to go to the inner values. Even in Ramcharitmanas and in other texts, it says, Ram Naam Sar Binu Anubhaye, without going deep within. Kabir Das Ji says, Jin Khoja Tin Paiyan Gehre Pani Pet. So till now, whatever we are doing in higher education, we are only working at the superficial level, which in Bhagavad Gita, it says that the whole creation is made of three gunas, Sat, Rajas and Tamas. So Lord Krishna, Dalai Lama Ji, was talking of our ancient knowledge. So ancient knowledge from Lord Krishna is that the whole world is of having three gunas, Sat, Rajas and Tamas. So Lord Krishna told to Arjun, Tregunyo Vishyo Veda, Veda is the interplay of three forces, Tregunyo Vishyo Veda, Nishtregunyo Bhavarjun. Arjun, you should go beyond the three gunas. You should take your awareness within to that silent level of awareness from where all the universal laws emerge. So modern science also, actually, because the time constraint is there, but doesn't matter. Here, this is the chart from physics, and I am very actually proud that Maharishi Mahesh Yogi's university in abroad, Maharishi University of Management, has already done some MOU. Here I want to tell you that we Indians now will be teaching the whole world, because India is known to be Jagat Guru. Now the modern science is indicating the unified field, and there is no objective technology to reach this unified field which physics is indicating. Only the human mind, we can take our awareness to that level, which is the level of transcendence. That is why this technology, when Maharishi introduced, he said transcendental meditation, a meditation through which you can transcend the mental activity and you can experience the state of Shiva. It says, I will also talk of knowledge, actually it says about Lord Shiva that Shivam Shantam Advaitam Chaturtham Manyante, means Lord Shiva, where Lord Shiva is? Shiva is in the silence. Shivam Shantam Advaitam, there is no duality there. Chaturtham, and that is known as the fourth state of consciousness. So here I would like to show this chart, which is important. Sir, here this sir, chart shows.
Sir, yes. We have 1 more minute. Sir.
Yes.
1 more minute.
Sir. Oh, doesn't matter. I will conclude. Right, 1 minute. Okay. Right. So it has been shown that through transcendental meditation, one goes to a state of consciousness which is completely different from waking, dreaming, and sleeping states of consciousness. And that is the state of consciousness, modern scientists have told, that is the restful alertness, transcendental consciousness. So not only Maharishi has given this technology to transcend and to experience the fourth state of consciousness, but then you may have heard, we also were saying that there should be no difference between me and you. We say, Aham Brahmasmi, Tattvatomasi, and Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma. So everything is Brahman. But it is not just lip saying, as His Holiness Dalai Lama Ji was saying, that it is not should be lips. It is a state of consciousness which we can develop through the technique of transcendental meditation. And Maharishi has developed a Maharishi Vedic science, which some of the universities, they are also opting. Vedic science tells you how from our own Atma, how from our own self, the whole creation has emerged. And the source of all creation is within our own consciousness. And that is why we can say that Sarve Bhavanti Sukhnam, or the whole world is a family, Vasudeva Kutumbakam. So they will not be just the sayings, but that will be the consciousness of the individual, as Lord Krishna has mentioned, as Lord Buddha has experienced. So that experience we can bring to our students and to our faculty. And we have very short-term courses, 5 days course, 1.5 hour every day, so that every university can go for it. And India, As Modi ji says, Sava Crore Janta jo hai, so we have got so many cosmic computers. If we program them well, then not only we can have more progress for India, but we can really create world peace. So I thank you all, because the time is not permitting to show you all the scientific charts that how transcendental meditation is just like watering the root so that the whole tree is nourished. So here I would like to invite all of you, whenever the time permits, I will be glad to have an interaction with you more at length, and we can introduce and can have MOUs for introducing the simplest technique of yoga and the Vedic science. So thank you all. Jai Gurudev.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for this quick. Of course, we will fall back to you. Now, I am very happy and delighted to call Professor Ashok Gowal, sir, from ISEC University, Bhopal. And I said delighted because I also come from Bhopal. So there is some kind of nostalgia when sir goes and speaks.
Thank you very much, Professor Roy. I'm really touched with when you say that you belong to Bhopal. This is basically the values. Our fellow speakers, Professor Samten, to whom my gratefulness is there for all hospitality and so many things. Learned Vice Chancellors. My job is very easy when I've heard Professor Sharma and Professor two speakers, earlier speakers, they have spoken. Then I feel that why shouldn't I start with the conclusion of my lecture? I give conclusion of my lecture because if you look at what we are all the time saying about this is human values and disruption. If you look at that disruption is basically coined West world, they have coined a word disruption, which is generated by us. And if you look at very philosophically, then you see that the human values, this is made by our forefathers. Very simple, but to follow it is very difficult. We know each and everything. My fellow Vice Chancellor, they said very nicely, through transcendental meditation, etc., we can do so many things. But it is very difficult to maintain value throughout the societies, whether it is the learned society, whether it is the village society, whatever it may be. Our experience says that we will have to now look for that, because we know both the things, disruption. To me, it is in the positive sense. If you look at that, then disruption can be made positive as far as technology. Few of the people, they mention like IoT and artificial intelligence. Then we can go further and make the world very comfortable. But to imbibe the values, it is very difficult, I tell you. It sounds very simple, but it is very difficult, and we found that. I have heard one of the lecture by IIT professor, and he said the induction of the courses on values and ethics. We are also teaching to our universities that values and ethics and so many things, so many negativity we are looking at, that how we cannot make it. Our teacher is also one of that. Because teachers, they don't want to be trained on that. But we are making it possible, and hopefully we can do that. And education is the only tree we'll have to plan. And if we can bring both the things, the disruption and the human values, anyhow, through the curricula, through the rule and regulations by University Grant Commission, or through any government body of the higher education, then it is very good. Otherwise, we can do, as far as the value is concerned, we can do by our own self. Nobody is going to restricting ourselves that we cannot make it out. We can make it. I'll just let you know that that we are having one. We have heard of that the we must be having the course, but we must be having it as a skilled. Then what we have done, we have removed that practical part of it, and we have introduced in the engineering part. At each semester, you'll have to complete two of the skill. Three semester that they are completing six skill, and one we have left. Four skills we are giving through the BTech degree, and two skill to the MTech degree, like that. And now we have introduced one of the values and ethics, and how it is going to be promulgated, how it is implicated, we are thinking very seriously, because few of these hindrances we are finding in between. And we have gone through all the things. I'm not taking much of the part. And this is, everybody knows that Indian education. And if you look at the human values, then only two things we are all the time defining, the values and the ethics. And it is third thing is very important, how to follow it. And we'll look into that. The Augustus family of the Vice Chancellor, they can think of, and they can think of very sternly that it should be promulgated in terms of curriculum activities. Under the curriculum activities, they can do that. And as I told you that it looks to be very simple, like love, brotherhood, all the things we are defining, all the things we are saying, but still we are moving, or we are just dwindling in between all the points what we are lacking, what we are seeing and what we are lacking. Only interception, introception, all this thing is there. And of course, later on, if at all it is there, then the meditation can go for having all this thing to be a reality. Our core human values is also very important, and while making curriculum, we must take care of all these points so that everything comes in and we can do some efficient initiative in that particular part. What I have found, what I felt, I have given in terms of the definition, though I had never mentioned or never elaborated the definitions, the types of the value which is needed once we are interacting with the society, with our immediate neighbors, with the immediate sort of professional, wherever you are working, then we go for it. And we'll have to see that we wanted to conserve the values. Unless until we are having the practical aspect of it, certainly we are not going to do that. It should be very practically handled. Once you look, disruption, everybody knows, I don't have to tell anything. It is moreover, we are talking about the technological disruption. I always take it as a positive that it is going to help our humanity. I cannot remember the saying of the Einstein, but he said it, that the such type of the technology which is going to grow, in one day our society is going to be scattered. Then it is somewhat, basically it is giving that, he never said anything for the values, but our society is scattered due to the disruptive technology. It is somewhat true. And we'll have to make it in a way, because the educational society can make it. University, they can do that. From the primary education, secondary education, and then higher education. And it should be the matter of concern for the government, for the political system, scenario. Everybody should be rather involved, then it could be done. It is lookingly, as I told you, that it is lookingly very simple, but it is very difficult, because we cannot make it out to the...
Sir, may please wind in 1 minute.
Okay, right. I'll do that, because nothing big I'm going to tell you. Everybody knows that. Few things I'm going to... this terminology everybody knows, I'm not going to tell. That is how I said it, that I'm going to conclude my lecture first, then I'll let you know something. Disruptive technology, yeah, we wanted to have that few of the definition we have given, few of the demographic sort of thing I wanted to explain, but it is very simple and clear also. And disruption, innovation in higher education, time versus performance, if you look at that, then it is the very recent graph which we have seen on the World Forum, that the disruptive technology is going, growing very fast. But what is the result? It is very different to say. And this is the concept, few of the concept we have given, like innovation, collaboration, organization, teaching, etc. we have given. And it is also mentioned that the MOOCs, massive open online courses, they are good also, but it challenges the employability, re-employability, and so many things it is coming to, we will have to look into. We'll have to also give pace to all these thoughts so that and make the programming in such a way that we can surpass the thing also and succeed also. Yeah, it is. I have given few of the things.
Thank you very much,
education,
sir.
Education is the most powerful things. Everybody knows that. Thank you very much. So nice of you.
Thank you very much, sir. May I now request Professor Samtain to please come and make his remarks.
Professor Sunil Raiji, the distinguished speakers on the dais, and the respected participant vice chancellors. We have a very limited time, so being a host, I should be sacrificing my time rather than snatching the time of others. So, we have been discussing about education and the problem of education at the global level. There are two things that we have to pay attention. One is the academic standard of, you know, the higher education, and the other is the human values, which is at a great problem at the global level. So far as academic standard is concerned, Western world is doing much better than us, and as somebody has said, that we are not even in the best 200 universities in the world. So therefore we need to work very hard in order to, let alone the human value, but in order to achieve the academic standard equal to the Western world. So therefore we have to differentiate these two things, the academic standard and the human value, because in the Western world also they have the same problem that we face here. And because, as His Holiness has said, we have followed the Western academic system, so we have left behind the human values that we used to have in our Gurukul and those Viharas in the ancient time. So the human values actually can be very much connected, and the ethics is very much connected to emotions and the mental state. It is not something to follow a certain set of rules, but it is something that we have to, you know, develop at the mental state and particularly at the emotional state. That is why from in 1980s, when the scientists had a discussion with His Holiness the Dalai Lama and some of the practitioners and philosophers, so when they learned that these destructive emotions, some of the emotions which are destructive in nature, when they came to know that they are really destructive and they can be reduced, they can be controlled, they were stunned to learn that. Because in India, this is not something new, but we had for thousands of years, we have the very kind of, you know, strong and detailed account of mind, and also strong and detailed comprehensive account of emotions, and then mind training through which this can be reduced and controlled and managed and regulated. So when they came to know, they became very serious and they started doing experiments. And on the basis of the scientific experiments, now they have started you know, implementing these at the public level, in the education system, at the school level and the college level. So recently, there was an international conference of mind and life at Dharamsala from 12 to 16, which was attended by the top neuroscientists, neuropsychologists, and educationists, the philosophers, and practitioners in which we discussed about the emotion. Now, there are many new areas have come up in neuroscience and psychology. For example, social emotional learning, about which you heard a little bit this morning. And then kind of, you know, the regulation of emotions and things like that. So these are being experimented and seriously, you know, researched in the Western world. And they have started implementing and, you know, educating the children in the school level and even at the level of a very, you know, kindergarten children, they have started teaching them very light meditation techniques and things like that. What I wanted to tell you in brief, because it is a very vast subject and that we cannot cover it, you know, in such a short period, and it will take a few hours, but I would like to just simply emphasize and focus on the emotion itself. Because after all, as I said, many of the people, most of the people do not relate ethics with emotion. In fact, ethics is the source, emotion is the source of ethics. So if we can control our emotion, then we can control our, we can be a very ethical person. Why we are not ethical is because we are not in a condition to regulate our emotions and control our emotions. So self-awareness here is emotional self-awareness. In these days, in the scientific research, now they have started calling it emotional literacy. We need to know the, you know, detailed account of emotions, what kind of destructive emotions are there, what are kind of, you know, positive emotions are there, and what are the nature of these, and what are the causes and conditions, what are their impact, how they can be tackled, and through what kind of mind training these can be reduced and, you know, regulated. So once we have a social awareness, self-awareness, then we are in a better condition to know our mindset. Because earlier people never, even some of the philosophers have even started saying, like for example, Aristotle said that, yes, you know, anger to some extent is permissible, and many of them, and for many of people that anger is permitted for certain reasons, even to the, you know, extent of explosion. So that kind of mentality existed in the past, even at the level of a very, you know, sophisticated philosopher's stage. And so if we have awareness of our emotions in terms of what are the natures of these emotions, how they come into existence, what are the causes and conditions, then we are better off in terms of understanding our own mindset. When we are unhappy, then we can look into ourselves and see what is the problem. We don't have to blame somebody else. We don't have to, you know, make others responsible, but to feel our responsibility and to feel ourselves responsible for whatever, you know, condition we are in. So we can just investigate. We don't have to go to a doctor. Just simply you can watch yourself and then figure out what problem is going on in your mind and then work on this. This is totally workable. And this is there are very rich mechanisms and mind trainings through which one can, you know, manage and identify. The problem right now is that people cannot identify those problems. They do not have, you know, awareness of the, you know, details of emotions, right? So that is the problem. Once we have, then what will happen? The next, that will lead us to self-management. We can manage our emotions. We can manage our anger. We can manage our hatred. We can manage our attachment. And then we can manage, on the positive side, we can, you know, understand the benefits and impact of compassion, and we can manage to cultivate it and make it better and, you know, heighten it, right? In that manner, we can be better off. So anger as such is something that is destructive in all means. No one has so far in our human history said that I felt so good because I was very angry this morning. No one has said that, because that is the poison that we have, and that destructive nature is already working in our mind, but people don't identify it. And even people do not, you know, understand the impact of that anger and these destructive emotions. Once we are in a position to manage it through our understanding, then we can manage ourselves, self-management, right? So then we go to, once we have the capacity to manage ourselves, then we can manage our friends and colleagues at work, and then we have a social management. And once we have capability of managing our colleagues and the society, then we can maintain a good relation. What, after all, society is all based on relation, right? So through our emotion, we react it or we reflect it through our behavior. And through behavior, we, you know, make a relation or we, you know, break our relation. So that is all about, now we can understand, it's all about emotion, that if you want to be happy, then you have to manage yourself. If you want to make your family happy, then you have to manage your, you know, emotions and the emotions of your family. And this is how we can manage. And this is doable, it is perfectly doable, and it is being done. And if you try it, you can do it. Often I used to tell that if you do it, it can be done instantly. It is more faster than 2 minutes noodle, right? So therefore, if we have this, and this entire emotional state is grounded on the understanding of reality. Again, this itself is a very big topic, but once you have the understanding of the reality of any given situation, on the ground of which you have developed anger or any kind of destructive emotion, then if you understand the reality of that very given situation, that will help a lot to undermine the basis of anger. And through that, you can regulate your emotion. There are so many means and ways of training yourself and regulating yourself. This is what these days in the Western world, SEL, social emotional learning. It is taught in the school, it is taught in the higher education, it is taught to the adult peoples in the society, and it works perfectly. And many people, millions of people, and as I mentioned briefly in my welcome speech, millions of students are benefited. Not adult, not just adult. Millions of children are benefited through training millions of teachers. So this whole mechanism and system originated from India, and why we are not using it? And why Western countries are, taking the benefits of it? It's very good, we appreciate that. They have taken all these things very seriously. But why we are not very serious about these mechanisms and the systems? So we can do it as the research, the results that has been, the statistic reports which has been shown this morning by Professor Lobsang Thenzin are all, results of the researches done in the Western world by Emory University, Stanford University, Yale University, Harvard University, and Wisconsin universities. They have a very strong department working on emotions and ethics. So we must establish some centers for ethics and also some scientific researchers which can work on emotion and ethics. I think this is the time that India must, start to do work on our ethics, because it has already deteriorated a lot, but we should not, make it go further into the, eclipse of the cliff of deterioration, but whether we can save it if we can introduce these methods scientifically in our universities. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. What we are going to do is, I have just an announcement. May I please invite, don't worry, this is not for any sharing of thoughts, but for a presentation, and you will all be delighted about this presentation. May I please invite Dr. Suryavanshi to please come here, Suryavanshi. And may I also invite the two young dynamic compares of yesterday, Karma and Nema. Are you there? So they are here. I think we must please acknowledge them. They led the day very well. Please come up on the stage. Yes. And Dr. Suryavanshi, thank you very much for this very fine gesture. He would like to make a presentation on behalf of all of us to these two young people who ran the show yesterday. Please come up and let's please acknowledge them.
Thank you so much, Rai sir. I think I would request Professor Samtin, his vice chancellor, to please come and give this. What is so amazing, because I think all of us have shared this, when these two students, very, very young students, when they did the comparing, it was so professional, I'm sure. So I think they deserve a big round of applause from all of sides. A job well done. That speaks volume of your gurus, teachers, vice chancellor and university in itself. Second, when this boy, Nema, the Nema means, he explained to me, it's like power of sun, something like that. And when he sang that song about Tibet, I can tell you, you skip many heartbeat there, including mine. So every dream has its day. So I think your dream has to wait for the day. And really pray for you. This is a small token of thing which I bought for. So ladies first, I think, Professor, I request you to give it to your student, Ms. Karma. And this is for Mr. Nema. Thank you so much. Thank you. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
There is a section of summarizing the proceedings. Itne vidwano ke vicharo ko, itne vidwano ke samne summarize karna, suraj ko diya dikhane jaisa hai. So, ye summaries mein aapke man mein rakhta hoon. Bahut badhiya, we have had an excellent interaction. There have been, of course, some profound dialogues, which is the need for metamorphosis of the education and the models of value ordering, which was suggested by our keynote speaker. And he also mentioned about the dignity of values, which as teachers, we have to inculcate value for values amongst our students, faculty and staff. Then of course, there was a profound statement made that what we are is more than what we have by Professor Madhumita. And of course, Professor Ahuja said, human values give worthiness to life itself. Technology is only a means. Professor Bhavesh sir talked about the transcendental meditation and transcendental consciousness. And I will urge, I am using this in my university to a great advantage, so people can contact him for transcendental meditation. And of course, our own Dr. Gaul, he talked about values. Education to be in the curricula, he also gave a lot of statistics and code of ethics, etc. Thank you very much for that, sir. And of course, our host, Professor Samtain, he talked about emotions. He emphasized on emotions because emotions is the source of ethics, he said. And through emotional literacy, one can manage oneself well and hence manage the society. So self-management leading to social management. And I think we had some profound exchange. Please join me in expressing our gratitude to all the panel speakers. And now, sir and ma'ams, you deserve the tea which is just laid outside along with the eats. Thank you very much.